Okay, see, the question says that a metal plate of 0.1 meter square, this is the area of the plate, it is connected to a 0.01 kg mass. This is 0.01 kg mass via a string that passes over an ideal pulley. This is the pulley, and this string is passing through it, and the free end of the string has been attached to a mass that is 0.01 kg. Now see, a liquid with film thickness, this is the liquid, the thickness of this liquid film is 0.3 millimeters. This is placed between the plate and table. This is the plate and this is the table. So in this way it has been placed. When released, plate moves to the right with constant speed of 0.085 meters per second. We have to find out the coefficient of viscosity. See, if mass M is attached to the free end, means if this is the pulley and M mass is attached to the free end, so there will be a gravitational force acting in the downwards direction. Yes or no?
Yes.
And see, since this is a string, it will exert tension, force of tension. So see what all data we have. We have the area. Area is 0.1 meter square, area of this plate. Now see, velocity, change in velocity. It, since it's a constant speed, we can write the velocity or dv, change in velocity as 0.085 meter per second. This is dv. Now see, we have thickness dx as thickness of the plate is given to us as 0.3 millimeters. So this would be 0.3. Instead of millimeter, let's convert it into meters. So area we have, velocity we have, change in the thickness we have. We have to find out the coefficient of viscosity. See, for the force, if this is in equilibrium, will the tension be equal to mg?
Yes.
Yes. So P will be equal to mg. Means this is the force that you want. F, that is the tension, is equal to mg. C, mass is given to us as 0.01. If we take the value of acceleration due to gravity as 10, 0.1 newton will be the force. So now we have the value of force as 0.1 newton. Can you remember any formula that links all these?
Fdx by adv.
F is equal to this coefficient of viscosity multiplied by area multiplied by velocity gradient. This, now see, force is known to us because of the tension. Coefficient of viscosity is unknown. Area is already known to us. dv, velocity, is known to us, and dx is also known to us. Is only coefficient of viscosity variable? Only this term is variable that we have to find out. So just let us put all the values. So eta would be equal to f dx divided by a d. Now see, if we put all the values, force is 0.1, thickness is 0.3 millimeters, divided by the area is 0.1 meter square, multiplied by the velocity, 0.085. So if you will solve this, you will get the answer approximately around 3.35 into 10 to the power minus 3. And the unit is decapoise. Aisha, what is the CGS unit of coefficient of viscosity? Yes, Aisha. Okay, for you tell me.
Ma'am, can you hear me?
Yes, Aisha, say.
Is it centimeter
No, no, see, SI unit for coefficient of viscosity is decapoise and the CGS unit is poise. All right.
Okay.
See, we have discussed the units in the previous class only this. SI unit for coefficient of viscosity is Newton seconds per meter squared. That is known as decapoise. And if you convert this whole term in CGS unit, that is known as poise. Just note down the solution for this. And wherever you get stuck, ask me.
Done.
See, now we have that is known as Stokes' law. So when a solid body moves through a fluid at rest, the fluid in contact with the solid is dragged with it like this whenever the solid moves. So this causes relative motion between the different layers of the fluid near the this solid. And then viscous force acts on the body that we have seen previously. So see, if I say this is a spherical body, R is the radius of the spherical body. And this is moving with velocity v towards the right-hand side. Tell me, what should be the direction of viscous force?
Left side.
Left side. So viscous force will be acting on the left side. So see, if v is the velocity of the body, fv is the viscous force, r is the radius of the body, then the viscous force experienced by the spherical body is given by this formula. Fv is equal to 6 pi eta r v. 6 pi multiplied by this. Eta is again the coefficient of viscosity. R is the radius of the sphere and v is the velocity. So for viscous force, for spherical body is given by this formula. Clear? Okay. This is known as Stokes' law. So according to this, viscous force depends on what? It depends on the radius of the spherical body. It depends on the coefficient of viscosity of the fluid. And it also depends on the velocity of the spherical body. It's, this derivation is done through dimension analysis. So for now, just remember what is the formula for Stokes' law. Note this. Yes, Aisha, is your network issue now fine?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, CC, we have just discussed Stokes law. So Stokes law is valid for spherical bodies. It means if this is a sphere, the sphere is having a radius capital R, it is moving with velocity on the right hand side. So obviously viscous force will act on the opposite direction so as to oppose the motion, because it is the internal friction viscosity we have seen, as we have seen. So see, the viscous force on a spherical body, whatever the spherical body will experience the viscous drag, that is given by this formula. 6 multiplied by pi eta r v, where v is the velocity of the body, Fv is the frictional, is the viscous force, and eta is again the coefficient of viscosity. So this is known as Stokes' law. So according to Stokes' law, viscosity or viscous force depends on the velocity of the body, the radius of the body, as well as the coefficient of viscosity. So this is known as Stokes' law. So just note this once.
Done, ma'am.
Both of you?
Yes, done.
All right. Now see, these are some important applications of Stokes' law. Like it was used in the Millikan's experiment for calculation of the charge on an electron using oil drop experiment was there. Then it accounts for the formation of clouds to find the size of small particles. So these are some important applications of Stokes' law. Now see, then we have a concept of terminal velocity. For example, I have taken a vessel and I have filled it with fluid. Now see, I have dropped a sphere in this. When I dropped it, its initial velocity, means the very first velocity before dropping, it was zero meter per second. There wasn't any velocity. Initial velocity was zero. Then what I've seen, after I have dropped it, then when it reaches a certain depth below the free surface, means over here, then I've seen the velocity is around 2 meters per second. It means it has gained some velocity. Initially it was at rest. Now the velocity has been increased to 2 meters per second. Now again, what I have seen, when it came downwards, means the height increases from the free surface. The velocity 3 again increased. And let's say it became 4 meters per second. So initially velocity was what? 0 meters. It means there wasn't any velocity. Then at a certain height, then at a certain distance, the velocity increased to 2 meters per second. And then again it increased to 4 meters per second. Now see, now again, according to this, the next velocity, when it reaches inward, it should be more than 4 meters per second. Yes or no?
Yes.
But what I have noticed is that V4 was also 4 meters per second. Then it came downwards. The height increased from the free surface. Then again, I've seen that the velocity is still 4 meters per second. So this constant velocity that has been achieved, this final velocity that is not changing now, this velocity is known as the terminal velocity. these are not terminal velocities. The final maximum constant velocity achieved by the body. See, the definition is also over here. The maximum constant velocity required by a body while falling freely through a viscous medium is called terminal velocity of the body. So see, what actually happens is that if this was the sphere, now tell me what all forces are acting on this. If this was the sphere inside it, this is the sphere, how many forces will act according to you? If it is moving downwards, which one?
Gravity and buoyant force.
Gravity and buoyant force upwards?
Yes.
Any other force?
No.
Yes, Aisha, do you see any other force?
Viscous force?
Viscous force, exactly. One force was missed by you. These are correct. Absolutely correct. One force. That is the viscous force. If it is moving downwards in the downwards direction, then the viscous force will act on the opposite direction. So what happens is that all the net resulting force is zero. The resultant force on the sphere is zero. So if the resultant force is zero, like you must have seen this in case of laws of motion also. Like when a body is moving, if the upwards forces balances the downward forces, then what do we say? The acceleration is zero. Just understand this first. If the upward force has balanced the downward force, then don't we say acceleration is zero? That's why they are in equilibrium. So forces are equal. So if acceleration is zero, what happens to the velocity? If acceleration is zero, then velocity is constant. Yes or no? Yes?
Yes.
So see, similar situation arises over here as well. When it reached this point, all the forces balanced each other. Over here, weight was greater. So that's why it was coming downwards and the velocity was increasing. When this height has been reached by this sphere. So what happens is that all the forces acting upward balances the force acting downward. So net acceleration is zero. And since the acceleration is zero, the velocity now becomes constant. And that constant velocity, that we call it as terminal velocity. So is the concept of terminal velocity clear? What is meant by terminal velocity?
Yes, ma'am.
Clear.
Okay, so just note the definitions and write the applications again. These are the applications. Viscosity of air or liquid is used in providing damping torque in measuring instruments. Oil is used as a lubricant. Okay, fine. You can even look at examples. Like if you drop a sphere in water and if you drop a sphere in honey, in which case will the sphere take more time to reach the bottom?
Honey.
Because honey is more viscous. Honey has greater coefficient of viscosity. So when in case of honey, this was honey and you have dropped a sphere, then again at some point, because of the viscosity offered by the layers of honey, the velocity will become constant. The final velocity with which the sphere will reach the bottom of the sphere, that velocity becomes constant. And that is known as the terminal velocity. So just note down these and wherever you need to ask questions, you can ask them. Then we'll see the how can we derive terminal velocity. Yes, Hishma?
Yes, ma'am.
Did you join just now or you heard this topic?
No, ma'am, I just joined.
Okay, fine. I'll repeat it. Meanwhile, both of them are writing. See, the body, whenever we have dropped the sphere, like I have given this example that there was a vessel and I filled it with a fluid. Then I dropped the sphere. The initial velocity of the sphere was zero when I dropped it. Then I've seen when it reached a certain depth from this, from the upper free surface, then the velocity increased, let's say to 2 meters per second. Then again, what I've seen, when the sphere reached a depth more, means the height increased from the free surface, then the velocity was 4 meters per second, means the velocity has increased now. So initially it was zero, then it reached a magnitude of 2, then it reached a magnitude of 4, means the velocity was increasing. So according to this pattern, the velocity should keep on increasing till it reaches the bottom. But what happened is that when I've seen further, the velocity is still 4 meters per second. And again, when it reached this much height also, means the greatest depth from the free surface, again the velocity was 4 meters per second. So this constant velocity that we are getting at the end, with which the sphere is reaching the bottom, that constant velocity is known as the terminal velocity. And why it happens is that at a certain depth, means let's say this depth which we were referring, the upward forces that are acting and the downward forces that are acting balance each other. So if the forces, net force is zero, if net force is zero, then net acceleration will also be zero. And if acceleration is zero, it means the velocity is constant. So this constant velocity, this maximum constant velocity that we achieve whenever any spherical particle or sphere is dropped through a viscous medium, that is known as the terminal velocity. Is it clear, Hishma?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so you also know this.
Done, ma'am.
All of you have written?
Yes.
Yes, Sushma, have you also written?
No, ma'am.
Okay, just take a minute, write down. Then we'll derive the formula for terminal loss.
Done, ma'am.
Okay, before deriving the formula, let's just look at the graph of it. If we draw the graph between the velocity and the time, see how it is going. If I take velocity on the y-axis, this is my y-axis. And this is the x-axis. And I've taken time on the x-axis. So if I plot a graph between the terminal velocity, the velocity and time, just for the time, see what will happen. What we have seen earlier, the velocity was initially increasing and then it reached a constant value, which was 4 meters per second in case of our example. So see, in this case, what will happen? The velocity will also increase. Initially, the velocity will increase. This is the zero. If this is zero, the origin. Velocity will increase, then it will become constant. These are all the increasing values where there was acceleration. And then here, finally, the acceleration came out to be zero. Acceleration became zero. So the velocity reached this constant value. Let's say if this was 4 meters per second. So at this moment of time, it was 4 meters per second. Then again, at this moment of time, again, it was 4 meters per second. And then again, at this moment of time also, it was 4 meters per second because the graph is not changing now. So it means that this value of velocity that we have finally now, where the acceleration is zero, this is our terminal velocity. So this is the terminal velocity at zero. Terminal velocity, which is now constant. This is the initial time where the acceleration was there, where all the forces were not equal. Downward force was greater, that's why the body came down. If the upward forces are greater, then body will move upwards, but the velocity will increase. So that graph will get between velocity and time is like this. Is the graph clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so let's just see the derivation of the viscous force. Now see, if again repeating, this is the sphere, this was the sphere that we took in the example, and these are the layers of the viscous fluid. Now see, again tell me, what all forces are acting?
Weight, buoyant force, and viscous force.
So weight will act in which direction?
Downward.
Weight will act in the downwards direction, fine. And the buoyant force?
Upward.
Up. Yes, upwards. Buoyant force will act upwards. And since it is moving downwards, where should the viscous force act?
Down.
No, see, this sphere is moving downwards. So viscous force will act on the opposite direction. Means upwards. This is the viscous force. Now see, if I write the net force that is acting on the body, the net force acting will be upward forces will be balancing the downward forces. So all the upward forces, it means the buoyant, sum of buoyant force and the viscous force. These will give me the weight of the sphere. Can I write the net forces like this? Fb plus Fv is equal to weight.
Yes.
Yes. Now see, we just have to find out the values and the formulas for each of these. And if we substitute it in this, we can get the value of terminal velocity easily. So see, regarding weight, first let us take what is weight. Weight is mg, the gravitational weight that we take. So see, if I have to eliminate mass using this relation, density is equal to mass by volume. If I wish to eliminate mass, can I multiply density with the volume?
Yes.
Yes. Now see, density of the body. We generally take the density of body as rho. We have taken it. Will volume, then volume of the body, let's say V. And then G is the acceleration due to gravity. So rho V G, this is weight. Rho V G. So we have got one value. Our right hand side has been solved. Now see, regarding buoyant force, what was the formula of buoyant force?
V sigma G.
V sigma G. Where sigma was?
Density of liquid.
Density of. So see, it was V sigma G. Again repeating, according to Archimedes' principle, we have solved this. V was the volume of the immersed part of the body. Sigma is the density of the liquid. And G is the acceleration due to gravity. So Fv we have as V sigma G. So we have weight, we have now value of buoyant force. Now see, one force is still left. One force, that is the viscous force. Now, you both know, but Hishma, for you, I'm repeating, we have just seen Stokes' law as well. In Stokes' law, what happened? Whenever a spherical body is with having radius capital R is moving with velocity. What happens is that the magnitude of the formula for viscous force, according to Stokes' law, is given by 6 pi eta R. Is it clear? Hishma, before you came, we had discussed this Stokes' law. So Stokes' law said that when the viscous force acting on a spherical body is directly proportional to the velocity of the body, is directly proportional to the radius of the body, and it is directly proportional to the coefficient of viscosity. So after using the dimension analysis, these were the constants, 6 pi eta are the constant. So Fv means viscous force is equal to 6 pi eta Rv. So again, now in the derivation of terminal velocity, we have all the values now. This is a spherical particle, so the viscous force, it will be equal to 6 pi eta R multiplied by V. Let's say this is moving with velocity V and the radius of the sphere is capital R. So do we have all the values for the three forces acting?
Yes.
Yes. Now see, let us just put all the values in this. Now see, at a certain velocity, that we say the terminal velocity, the body will be in equilibrium. So V sigma G plus 6 pi eta Rv is equal to V rho G. This was the weight, this was the buoyant force, and this was the viscous force. This was our equation, and now we have substituted all the values, the three values that we have got. Now see, V, just to differentiate, this is small v is the velocity and capital V is the volume. All right, so don't get confused by this small v. This is the velocity. These are the volume of the spherical body. Now see, if I take all the terms over this side, means let us keep this term. 6 pi eta rv over here, then what will we be left with? V rho g minus V sigma g. Yes? V rho g will be equal to V sigma g. Now see. If we take V common, 6 pi eta rv would be equal to V is common, g is common. So we are left with rho minus sigma. Is this step clear to you?
Yes, clear.
Clear? Now, so we have to find out this velocity, the terminal velocity. So as to find out this, let us transport all this term, all these terms to the right-hand side. So velocity will be equal to V, G, rho minus sigma divided by 6 pi eta multiplied by R. Now see, volume of a sphere. We already know the volume of a sphere. What is the volume of a sphere from your mathematics? Volume of a sphere is given by 4 by 3 pi r cube. This is the volume of a sphere. So if we substitute the volume of a sphere, means 4 by 3 pi r cube, then this g, all this term, rho minus sigma, and the terms that were in the denominator, 6 pi eta r. Now see what all will be cut down. 2 can be multiplied and 2 can be, 3 can be multiplied. So 2 multiplied by 2 would give 4 and 2 multiplied by 3 would give us 6. R will cancel this r cube, only r square will be left. So the final formula for the terminal velocity will be 2 and 9 from this, 3 into 3. So 2 by 9 r square g rho minus sigma divided, see pi will also get cancelled. This 4 pi and this pi. So divided by eta. This will be the final formula of the terminal or terminal velocity. See what we have done. We have just taken out all the values for buoyant force, viscous force, as well as the weight of the body. We have put in the values. We have taken Vg common because volume of the body and acceleration due to gravity was common. And in order to find this small v, velocity of the body, we have transported everything on the right-hand side. Now see, just volume of sphere is 4 by 3 pi r cube. So we have put this value. After cancellation, we are left with this. So is the derivation and expression of terminal velocity clear to you?
Yes, clear.
Yes? So you know this from the graph. All of you write it. And wherever you are having any doubts, you can ask me in between.
And can you scroll down?
Done.
All of you, Aisha, Hishma, you
want to? Yes, ma'am.
Oh. Now see, again repeating. The terminal velocity of a spherical body falling freely through a viscous force is directly proportional to the square of the radius of the sphere. Now see, again, terminal velocity is also proportional to, it is directly proportional to the difference of the densities of the body and the density of the fluid. Rho is the density of body. I've written it also. Rho is the density of body. And sigma is the density of liquid. It is inversely proportional to the coefficient of viscosity and all these. 2/9 is constant. And acceleration due to gravity is also constant. So this is the final formula of terminal velocity that we get. Now see, how will we determine whether the body is moving downwards or the body is moving upwards? For this, we have two cases. See, if the density of the body is greater than the density of liquid. So see what the formula was. Vt was 2/9 r squared g divided by eta. Now see, there was this difference, rho minus sigma. So everything depends on this now, rho minus sigma. If the density of the body is greater than density of the liquid, means Vt is directly proportional to rho minus sigma, and the density of the body is greater than the density of liquid, means this term is greater. So if higher, this is the higher term and this is the lower term. Will we get the value or the difference as negative or positive?
Positive.
Because this is greater. This is a much greater term than this. Like if you write 3 - 2, so you get positive 1. Why? Because 3 is greater than 1. Similarly, rho minus sigma would be greater than 0. So if rho minus sigma is greater than 0, why? Because rho is greater than sigma, then the velocity that we will be getting, since this term is positive, the terminal velocity we will be getting, that will also be positive. So since the terminal velocity is positive, the body dropped in the liquid will move in the downwards direction. So body will move downwards with the terminal velocity. Now see just the reverse of this case. If density of body is less than the density of liquid, what will happen? Density of the body minus the density of liquid. This is the proportionality to the terminal velocity. So if the second term is greater, means now there was 3 - 2. Now this is 2 - 3. This is -1. So this term will also be negative. So terminal velocity will be negative. So if the terminal velocity comes out to be negative, then the body moves upward with terminal velocity. And for both the examples of these cases, if you want to take the example, you can say, if a water drop has been dropped in air, the way raindrops occur. When the water drops in air, what happens? Density of the body means the water is much greater than the density of air. The density of water is greater than air. So that's why raindrops appear to fall. And see, you can take the example of air bubble in water. Air bubble in water, the density of water is greater than density of air. So it means the density of the liquid is greater. So that's why what will happen? The air bubbles move on towards the free surface in the upwards direction. So this is how you can determine whether the body will move upwards or the body will move downwards depending on the greater density. Which density is greater than? If the density of body is greater than density of liquid, then the body drops. If the density of the body is greater than, if the density of body is less than the density of liquid, the body rises. Clear?
Yes.
Okay. So note these two cases, then we'll do numericals on terminal velocity.
Mom, can you scroll down? Done, ma'am.
Now see, there's a numerical. It says that a water drop in air has terminal velocity 100 meter per second. 8 such drops combine to form a bigger drop. We have to find the terminal velocity of the bigger drop. The terminal velocity of the smaller drops we have, but we don't have the terminal velocity of the bigger drop. See, if we have small 8 drops with us, small 8 drops are there. And if they all coalesce and combine to form a bigger drop. So can any of you tell me which quantity over here will be equal to the quantity over here? Any quantity that will remain same if these drops combine. See, radius density. Won't be the same. What?
Density.
Yes, density will be same. Density will be same. Anything else? Density will be same because the material is same. See, let's say these are the small spheres with radius as small r. And this is the bigger sphere with radius capital R. One quantity that will also remain same along with density is the volume. All the volume of these spheres, if you combine and sum up all the volume of the 8 spheres, will be equal to the volume of this because this has been composed of this only. All these small drops have combined together to form the bigger drop. So the volume that each of them possess, if the whole volume is combined, then won't be it equal to this volume of the bigger sphere?
Yes.
Yes. So the volume of the 8 drops, all these 8 drops will be equal to the volume of this bigger sphere, volume of bigger drop. Because no mass has been added up, no mass has been taken out, density is also same. So the volume also remains same. The bigger drop. Now see, again, I have just told you, what is the formula for volume of a sphere?
4 by 3 pi r cube.
So if small r is the radius of one of them, so the volume for this one small sphere will be equal to 4 by 3 pi small r cube for one sphere. See, this is not a single sphere over here. These are 8 spheres. 8 drops of water. So we have to multiply 8. So 8 drops of small water are equal to 1 bigger drop. Means 4 by 3 pi capital R cube. Is this step clear? How I have written this?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Now see, from this 4 by 3 will get cancelled. We will be left with 8 small r cube equal to capital R cube. If we take the cube roots from both the sides, cube root of 8 is 2. R cube will get cancelled to small r and the cube root of R cube is again capital R. So have we established a relation between the small r and the capital R? Small capital R is twice the small r. Means the bigger sphere that we are getting is actually the double. Sum of all these, which is the double of this small radius. Now see, if we take the terminal velocity, for taking the terminal velocity, the terminal velocity for the smaller spheres, this, that is mentioned was already 100 meter per second. If we write the formula, it would be 2 by 9 r square g multiplied by rho minus sigma divided by eta. This is the first, let us write the general. This is the general formula for terminal velocity. As we have seen few minutes back, the terminal velocity formula was 2 by 9 r square g rho minus sigma, density difference in the density is divided by eta. Now see what all terms are constant. The difference in the density of the smaller sphere, will it be equal to the difference in the density of bigger sphere? It means the density of air and the difference in the density of air and the density of water. Will it change when it will combine?
No.
No. So density will remain same. Because here also the outer fluid was air and the inner body is water. Here also outer fluid is air and the inner body is water. Means the water drop. So difference in density won't be there. Acceleration due to gravity is constant. 2 by 9 is a constant number. Coefficient of viscosity. Since the material is same, means water drop was over here as well as water drop is here also. So coefficient of viscosity's value will also be same. Now on which factor now the terminal velocity depends on this question. All the terms are constant except the radius. So terminal velocity is directly proportional to the square of the radius because the rest of the terms are constant. Is this clear? Why have we excluded all the terms?
Yes.
Clear to all?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now see, from this only you can take if the velocity of the smaller sphere is Vs, it is directly proportional to R square divided by terminal velocity of the bigger sphere that is unknown to us. It would be R square, capital R square, and capital R square is actually this value of capital R is 2R. So it would be the square of 2R. This will be 4 multiplied by R square. Yes or no? If you write r square, this would be 2 small r square. So r square would be equal to 4 r square. So Vb means terminal velocity for the bigger sphere. It would be 4 into r square. Now see, velocity of the bigger sphere is now coming as 4 multiplied by Vs. Means 4 times the terminal velocity of the smaller sphere. And the terminal velocity for the smaller sphere is 100 meter per second, as provided by the question. So Vb will now equal to 4 into 100, that is 400 meter per second. So is this clear to you, all of you?
Yes, clear.
Okay, so just note down the question as well as try to write down the solution on your own. Wherever you get stuck, look on the screen.
Done, ma'am.
Anyone writing?
Done.
So let's just see one more numerical. This is also an easy one. It's easier than the previous one. Terminal velocity of water drop in air is 200 meter per second. Terminal velocity of water drop in air is 200 meter per second. If the radius of the drop is 2 millimeters, then we have to calculate the coefficient of viscosity and the density of air is given to us. Terminal velocity of water drop in air. Air is there and a water drop is over here. Now see, if this water drop is here, this is water, this is air. So the fluid, the liquid is air, not the liquid, no, the fluid is air and the body is the water drop. If we write the formula for the terminal velocity, it is 2 by 9 r squared g. Then the difference in the densities and inversely proportional to the coefficient of viscosity. So this is unknown to us. So if we write eta, it would be equal to 2 r square g rho minus sigma divided by 9. And just now, these have been exchanged. The coefficient of viscosity over this side and terminal velocity will come downward. Now see, looking at the question, each of you tell me. Yes, Akifa, first you tell me. What is the radius value of r?
2 millimeters.
2 millimeters. So if you convert it into SI unit, it should be?
2 into 10 raised to minus 3 meters.
Minus 3 meters. 2 by 9 is there instead of r square. We can write 2 into 10 to the power minus 3 whole square. Acceleration due to gravity is 10. Yes, Aisha, what is the terminal velocity? Is there any terminal velocity mentioned?
It's 200 meter per second.
200 meter per second. So terminal velocity is 200 meter per second. Now see, difference in densities. Yes, Hishma. Density of body minus density of liquid fluid. What is the density of the body?
1 kilogram per meter cube.
Okay, what is the body over here? This is the case, water has been dropped in air. What is the body and what is the fluid?
Body is water.
Body is water. So density of body minus density of the liquid or the fluid. So density of body means the density of water. Do you remember the density of water? I've told you all not to forget the density of water in CGS as well as SI unit. In SI unit, the density of water, anyone?
1,000.
1,000, yes, exactly. 1,000 kg per meter cube is the density of water in SI units, and 1 gram per centimeter cube is the SI unit of, in the CGS unit of water. So you have to remember this. See, in this question also, it wasn't mentioned. So density of body is 1,000, means the density of water, minus the density of the fluid. This is the density of fluid that is being provided to us, means 1. So are the data substituting here? How have we put all the value? And by solving this, you will get this final coefficient of viscosity. So write down this also.
Ma'am, can you show the question?
Yes, written.
Yes, done.
Others?
Done, ma'am.
Now see. Let us see the pattern, how the fluids flow. In the sense, types of flow, how the flow. You see, for the first type, that is known as the streamlined flow or the steady flow, you have to take an example. Like if I take a curved pipe like this, I have taken a pipe and I have allowed the fluid to flow in this. Filled it with, I've allowed the fluid to flow through. Now see, let us mark few points. This is point A, this is point B, this is point C. Now see, whenever the fluid particle came on this point A, the velocity was V1. Then when the particle came at point B, the velocity was V2 meter per second, so some value of V. Then when the particle came at point C, the velocity was V3. Okay, so the flowing of liquid is said to have a certain velocity, V1 at this point A, and V2 at this point V, and V3 at this point C, and so on. Whatever all the points are there, they're having their unique separate velocities. Now see, if with the passage of time, the velocity of whatever liquid particles happens to be at A, whatever the liquid particle happens to be at A, is still V1. And then whichever particle is coming at point B, the velocity is still V2. And similarly, whatever particle, the next particle of the liquid or the water that has been taken is coming, still the velocity at this particular point is V3. If these velocities are constant, means these velocities are same, the values are not changing by the passage of time and with the passage of all the particles and the fluid, then the flow that we get is known as steady or the streamlined flow. So every particle starting from point A will follow the same path that has been passed by the previous particle. So this ordered flow, because every point is exhibiting same velocity at that particular point, this ordered organized flow, this is known as the streamline flow or the steady flow. This is the ordered flow. And this path followed, this curved path followed. This path followed is called the streamline. The streamline shape. So the first type of liquid flow that we encounter is the streamline flow or the steady flow, which says that the flow of a liquid is said to be a streamline flow or steady flow if all the liquid particles that pass a given point follow the same path at the same speed. If all the particles of the fluid follow the same path, the same track, the same pathway with the same speed at all the points, then that type of flow we get is known as the streamline flow or the steady flow. And this is the steady ordered flow. Now see, laminar flow is a special case of streamline flow. It is the ordered flow, but it's just in terms of layers, that all the layers are parallel. Like if these are the liquid layers, and if the layers of liquid are parallel, similar to this case that we have seen previously in case of streamline, all the properties are same, the velocities at each point will be same, whichever particle, it's not said that V1 is equal to V2 is equal to V3. The velocities can be different at all the points. It's just that whatever particle comes at this point will exhibit this velocity, V1. It's not that V1 and V2 and V3 are equal. And if the layers are parallel, like in this was a curve, streamline shape. If all these particles or the layers of the fluid are spread and are parallel to each other, then the smooth streamline flow that we get, that is known as the laminar flow. So it's just a case of streamline flow only. The difference is that the path of the particle was streamlined over here. And in this case, the laminar flow, the path of the particles are parallel to each other. The fluid forms in the form of layers. The fluid flows in the form of layers. So in case of non-viscous, it will flow like this. And in case of viscous fluid, the velocities flow like this. This type of parallel flow is in case of non-viscous fluid. And this velocity profile formed by the layers of the liquid is when the fluid is in the viscous medium. And now see, if the path of the fluid is disordered, in the sense, let's say this is a pipe. So fluid is coming from here and it is getting distorted over here. Means now the velocity of the particle that is coming here and going, and then the next particle that will be coming here and will be going, will not be the same. Now the velocities that will be crossing this particular point when this fluid will get distorted, that is known as the turbulent flow. So the flow of the liquid is said to be turbulent flow or disorderly flow if the speed and direction of the liquid particles passing at any point change with time. Let's say if the velocity of the first particle was 4 meters per second towards this side, this direction, then the next particle that will come at this point, it will not be equal to 4 meters per second with this direction. It will be some other value of the velocity with different direction, because this is a disordered flow in a disorderly manner. So if the narrow constriction is there, the fluid is getting disordered. Instead of following a given path, the molecules or the particles of the liquid form different patterns. So are the three types of fluid flow clear to you all? Streamlined flow, laminar flow, and the turbulent flow. Basically, there are two types of liquid flow only, streamline and turbulent. If the path is ordered, velocities and direction of the particle at a particular point is same, then that is streamlined. And if it is not same, then that is turbulent. Just if all the layers of the fluids are parallel, then the velocities at each point that we get is in the form of laminar flow. Is this topic clear to you all?
Yes.
So just note these three points of the types of flow. Make the heading as types of liquid flow. Write the first point. If the flow of liquid is like this, this is the streamline flow. Whenever you have to find out the direction, you have to drop a tangent on the surface like this. This will give you direction of velocity. So that's why streamline particles, streamlines cannot cross. Means if the water is flowing like this, all the layers will flow like this. Any layer won't cross each other. See, if it is crossing, then what will happen? Let's say if these two layers of the fluid have crossed each other in the streamline manner, the direction of the velocity at this point will be this, and the direction of velocity at this point will be this. So the same velocity is there over here, but this velocity is having two directions. One in this side, one in this side. And a single velocity cannot have two directions. That's why we say two streamlines can never intersect each other. So that's why the pattern is orderly over here. The streamlines do not cross.
Done, ma'am.
Written.
Done, ma'am.